Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to welcome everybody to this afternoon's College of Science and Engineering Colloquium. We're honored to have with us today one of the most famous physicists, not only in Latin America, but in the world, in the area of statistical physics. It gives us great pleasure this afternoon to welcome Dr. Constantino Tsallis to the American University of Armenia. Professor Tsallis is a pioneer in applying statistical physics to fields in which it's not usually applied. Complex systems, critical phenomena, biogenesis, chaos, nonlinear dynamics, immunology, economics, cognitive psychology, population evolution, and many other fields. Fields where you won't, if you open up a statistical physics textbook, you won't necessarily find things about these fields. And I'll let him go into why and what he's doing differently. Dr. Tsallis is based in Rio de Janeiro, where he's head of the Department of Theoretical Physics at the Brazilian Center for Physics Research. He's also the head of the National Institute of Science and Technology for Complex Systems, which has researchers spread throughout Brazil. He's also co-director of the International School of Complexity in Erice, in Sicily. He was born in Athens, Greece, and grew up in Argentina. He attended university in Argentina, Bariloche. He did his graduate work at the Sorbonne, University of Paris, where he obtained the title of Docteur d'État des Sciences Physiques in 1974. He then moved to Brazil, where he lives today, but he also, during that time, held postdoctoral positions at Oxford University, at Boston University, and at Cornell University. He has received numerous international and national distinctions. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences of Brazil, as well as the Academy of Economical, Political, and Social Sciences of Brazil. He's also the main editor of the Elsevier journal, Physica A. I'm actually an assistant editor of that journal, so he's my boss in that respect. He has received four titles of Doctor Honoris Causa by universities, four different universities in Brazil, in Argentina, and in Greece. He is the recipient of the Mexico Prize of Science and Technology, which is one of the most prestigious scientific honors, including scientists in all of Latin America, as well as Spain and Portugal. The President of Brazil also awarded Dr. Tsallis the National Order of Scientific Merit. His most, the contribution for which he's best known, and which he will discuss today, is the generalization of statistical physics. Namely the Boltzmann-Gibbs theory of statistical physics, addressing, and the goal here is to extend statistical physics to non-equilibrium systems, to systems that are typically non-ergodic, living systems with correlations, as opposed to just inert matter, as opposed to the study and the application of statistical physics just to solids, liquids, and gases, as is usually the case. This generalization of statistical physics is being actively studied throughout the world. There are somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 articles on Professor Tsallis's generalization of statistical physics by well over 5,000 scientists from around the world, and well over 10,000 ISI citations as well. Over 2,300 citations alone were for his original paper on the subject. He has spent much time traveling, speaking, and engaging in many research institutions throughout the world. He has co-authored a number of papers from his association with the Santa Fe Institute in New Mexico, where he has collaborated with, for example, Nobel laureate Marie Gell-Mann. The volume of his accomplishments is such that I could probably fill up the whole hour if I keep going through them. So I think that I won't do that, and instead I'll just introduce his talk today. It's entitled Complexity in Natural, Artificial, and Social Systems, and he will describe the general idea that complexity in such systems is conveniently characterized by the nature and the strength of the correlations between the different parts of the system. Afterwards, we will have a brief question and answer session here, but then you are all welcome to join us up in the Akyan Gallery on the fourth floor in the west wing of this building. There'll be food there too and lots of opportunity for informal discussion with Professor Tsallis and with each other. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming our distinguished guest, Dr. Constantino Tsallis.
I must say it's a great pleasure to be here in Armenia. What happens? It's okay? I don't know, they're making some signs. Okay. So it's a big pleasure for a variety of reasons. First of all, because when I was a child in Argentina, in my family, we had a very good friend from my parents. We were together practically every week. And they were Armenian. They spoke Greek, but they were Armenian. And I remember very well the face of the lady, and her face I recognize in many Armenian women.
Very complex faces.
Complex faces. Beautiful girl. And another reason is that since 16 years, I know the president, Bruce Barbosian, so it's a pleasure to meet him here. Another reason is my father used to tell me stories about the Silk Road, about Armenia, about Samarkand. So, as you see, I have many reasons to be happy to be here. So let me start with this. And let me tell you the main idea of what I'm going to talk to you. First of all, I know you are from various fields, so I do not expect everybody to understand everything that I'm going to say. A few of you will understand everything or almost everything that I would say, but some of you will understand only part. But it doesn't matter. Anyhow, we never understand everything. So if at the end of this talk you have the feeling that you didn't lose completely your time, I will be very happy. So let me start with this concept. You see this table, so it has a surface, the surface of the table. And if I ask you, what is the volume of the surface? The surface is a planar object, right? What is the volume of the surface? Can anybody say what's the volume of the surface?
Zero.
Because it has no height, right? So it's a kind of silly question with a kind of trivial answer. So it's not fun. Now I will change the question. I will ask what is the length of the surface, the length. Can anybody guess what's the length that fills the surface? It's infinity. Another silly question with a rather trivial answer. So let me now make the intelligent question. What is the intelligent question? What is the area? The area of this is, for example, 2 square meters, not zero, not infinity. Zero and infinity are dreams. 2 square meters is not a dream, it's this. And it is different from the surface of that table that has possibly 3 square meters instead of 2. So if I go to a shop and I want to buy mosaic for the bathroom of my house, I cannot tell him I want mosaic for 0 cubic meters of bathroom, because he will say this guy is crazy. I have to tell him I want mosaic for 20 square meters, not cubic meters, of mosaic, and then he goes and he brings the box. So, who is telling us what is the intelligent question to put here? Is it us? No. It is the system. It is the geometry of the system that tells you. If you want to, you can put all kinds of questions. You can put stupid questions. But if you want to be to put an intelligent question, ask the area. That's the intelligent question for a surface. Well, what I'm going to argue, let me give you another example here. You have this object, which is a fractal, and you see it has, say, 10 centimeters. In the next hierarchy, you eliminate this. In the next hierarchy, you eliminate this. I think it's mine that is making this noise. Well, you know, these companies never stop. It's the Brazilian company just making me messages to buy things. As you see, they never stop. So here, you eliminate the central third, and you have this hierarchy. Then you go further, you eliminate the central third here and here, and you go down forever, and at the bottom, you have a fractal. It's a lot of points. It's not an empty set. It's a very fragile set, but it is not the empty set. So if you want to ask the size of these, are you going to say how many meters or square meters or what? The intelligent question for this thing is, what is the measure in not centimeters, not square centimeters, but centimeters to the power 0.6309, because this number is the fractal dimension. So for this object, the intelligent question demands a funny measure, which is a fractal measure in this case. So what I'm going to tell you, that the entropy, I'm going to talk a lot about entropy, the entropy of a system, which is a measure of ignorance on the system, the entropy, you are not going to decide what is the entropy. The system will tell you what is the entropy that you must use. The system tells you. The geometry and the dynamics of the system says, if you want to talk with me with an informational tool, like Shannon entropy, you must use this informational tool. So it depends on the system, not on you, not on the commandments of God. It depends on the system. So this fractal thing, it has to do with what? With symmetries. So there you have translational symmetry. An example here, you take one piece of this and you translate it and you recover the entire world, the entire wall. You have reflection, you have an axis, that's a different symmetry. You have rotation by 60 degrees, a different symmetry. And you have a funny symmetry here, which is called scale symmetry. So you take this, you amplify, you have this, and then you take a piece of it, and the piece of it has a similar shape to the whole of it. And then you take a piece of a piece, and it has again the same shape as whole of it. So there you have a lovely subject for the next time you're going to a bar to drink beer. Because we are accustomed that the parts are inside the whole. But I'm telling you here that the whole is inside the parts. So what about that? The whole is contained into the parts of it. So you need some beer, some wine to understand better these kind of things, right? So there you know how these kind of things work. And for example, here you have a fractal, and you take a piece of it, which is this, and you take a piece of the piece, which is this, and they all have basically the same shape. This scaling symmetry, a subtle one, it is behind many things that I will tell you. It is behind many things that have to do with complexity against simplicity. And I will come back onto that. And first of all, talking about entropy, I know some of you have never heard about entropy. All of you have heard about energy. So because we hear many times the word energy, we have the impression that we understand. That's a human characteristic. You hear it a lot of times and you think you understand. So not necessarily all of you understand what is entropy. Not necessarily anybody understands what is entropy or energy. But energy is more common than entropy. But let us have a look what Enrico Fermi, Nobel Prize, and one of the most distinguished physicists in the 20th century, what he says in his book, Thermodynamics, from 1936. He says, the entropy of a system composed of several parts is very often equal to the sum of the entropies of the parts. He says, very often. An intelligent man like Enrico Fermi does not write very often just like that. It's because in his mind, he has a counterexample, he has some subtlety, he has something in his mind. This is why he writes very often. So the not always is to what my talk is dedicated. Have a look on this table. Those that know a little bit of mathematics, appreciate it. Those who don't, it's a pity, because mathematics can be very beautiful. So those who don't, just study a little bit of mathematics. So this line is Boltzmann-Gibbs-Shannon von Neumann entropy. It's the same mathematical object, which is minus the sum of probability, logarithm of probability. These are all equal in the central cemetery. In the cemetery you have also Johann Strauss, Schubert, and you have a statue of Mozart. The central cemetery of Zurich in Switzerland, but it is the double fun. The cemetery is more fun than Zurich, although it has surrounded by people that... Exactly. I was telling right now to the president and to Michel that Goethe, there is a passage which is extremely interesting in Faust, and in that passage, Mephistopheles is explaining to Faust how the humans are. And Mephistopheles knows a lot about humans because he is the devil. So he knows. And he says to Faust, the humans are like this. When they do not understand something, they put a name. And they are all satisfied. So you don't need to understand strictly what is entropy, but it has a name, entropy. And we are all satisfied, and we are talking about that. I'm going to refer especially to this line, where you see immediately there is an extra letter, Q. If in this line you take Q equal 1, this line becomes this line. And therefore, I am not talking about an alternative to Boltzmann, Gibbs, von Neumann, Shannon entropy. I'm talking about a generalization of it, because it has the other one as a particular case. This line has been able to explain 140 years of physical phenomena. So this is a great line. We don't want to change it. We want to make it more powerful, to be able to address other systems in which that one faith. But so here you have a function p log p, and this is a generalization of this function. And given a function, there is a trillion of possible mathematical generalizations. And for those who know a little bit of mathematics, it's very easy to generalize a function. So an engineer, a mathematician, a physicist can generalize a function very quickly. So why this particular generalization among 1 trillion of possibilities, why that one? Well, that's a long story. But let me tell you that this one is a kind of minimalistic generalization of that one. It's like a Zen generalization of the other one. You know, you touch just a little bit. So these two, they share a lot of important properties, like concavity, extensivity, a lot of things. These two are very recent. These appeared in 2011 by a group from Japan, and these appeared this year by a group from Hungary. But of course, you must violate something, because the only thing that violates nothing is p log p, and you have not generalized. So if you want to generalize, you must violate at least one property. We are going to violate additivity. This expression is additive, this expression is non-additive. And I will come back onto this word. So, violating additivity is, and I think Bruce Bogosian made many years ago a comment along that line, is similar. If you take Euclid axioms for geometry, there are 5 postulates. The 5th one has been an intriguing postulate during centuries. The 5th one says, from a point outside a straight line, there is one parallel and only one parallel otherwise. This postulate, if you violate it, if you abandon it, like here we are abandoning activity, you get the so-called curved geometries, Lobachevsky, Riemann, and with the curved geometries, you can do a lot of things, and in particular, you can invent general relativity, which is what Einstein did in 1915. And by inventing general relativity, he made an intellectual, very interesting breakthrough. But for not saying that it is useless, general relativity has a practical application also, only one, which is in your cell phones. The GPS that you have in your cell phone uses corrections coming from general relativity. So if your cell phone detects a car here, the car is here and not there, because the relativistic, the general relativistic correction is being incorporated through talented engineers in your cell phone. This for not saying that it is completely useless. So let me go on and let me talk about this word and this word, additivity. So this is the one we are going to violate. So I'm taking the definition by Oliver Penrose, Foundations of Statistical Mechanics, 1970. So he says an entropy is additive if, for any 2 probabilistically independent systems, the entropy of the sum equals the sum of the entropy. Remember the sentence by Enrico Fermi? If it is like this, it is additive. If it's not like this, it is non-additive. Very simple. SQ, the entropy I was talking here, this entropy, you can prove in 3 lines that it satisfies this. And therefore, SQ is non-additive. Excepting Q equals 1, where this disappears, and you go back here, and you go back to Boltzmann, Gibbs, Shannon, von Neumann, which is additive. So So this is additivity. What is it? Extensivity? Extensivity is much more subtle. Extensivity is the entropy of n particles, or the entropy of n degrees of freedom is proportional to n. If it is so, we will say that the entropy is extensive. If it is not so, we will say that the entropy is non-extensive. Now, what is this? As you know, the science of nutritionists is based on the fact that if you eat an ice cream of 200 grams, I'm pointing you because you don't have that problem. So if you eat an ice cream of 200 grams, you get inside the double of calories than if you eat an ice cream of 200. An ice cream of 200, you get inside the double of calories than if you eat an ice cream of 100 grams. The double. Not three times, not square root of 2. In fact, square root of 2 is a very complicated concept for most nutritionists. It is exactly the double. So this is the basis of their sciences. Now you know what is the basis of the science of nutritionists. The entropy is proportional to n. Now, if you invent an entropy and you give it to me, and you ask me, is it additive? I can answer to you in 20 minutes if it is additive or not. But then if you ask me, this entropy that I invented, for this system, because the professor also can be seen as a system. So, this entropy, for that system, is it extensive? I might be unable to give the answer in 20 years. This is a simple thing that you can answer right away. This is a very complex thing, because it has to do with the correlation inside the system of the elements of the system. So this is subtle. So, I would like that you understand the difference between these two words. And let me try to succeed to that with two examples, here and here. So, this is the total amount of possibilities. This W is the W that is on the grave of Boltzmann. Boltzmann entropy is logarithm of W. This W is this. So this is the amount of possibilities. If you have n coins, this is 2 to the power n. Right? Because it can be head and tail, head and tail, head and tail. So the whole is 2 to the power n possibilities. Now, in such a system, arrives a new coin, and the new coin says, multiply your possibilities, which is 2 to the power n, by the two possibilities that I like, which is head and tail, multiply. And the others say, no problem, this is a free country, we multiply 2 to the power n times 2, which gives you 2 to the power n plus 1. So they are all very satisfied, and they are very lonely, because independence goes together with loneliness. Don't forget that. People like to say, I want to be independent. Okay, but do you want to be lonely? Because they go together. Now, a different system. Instead of being exponential with n, it is a power law of n. N, say, n squared. So here, the coin arrives and says, multiply your possibilities by the two that I like, head and tail. And the others say, not at all. Here, we have strong correlations. We have language. We have music. We have poetry. Emily Dickinson. John Milton. We have grammar. Grammar is plenty of correlations. We have Wall Street. We have living organisms. Living organisms are very complex, and they have big correlations. If I cut here the air like that, I cut in the air, and now, okay, it's the same. If I cut her arm, she goes to hospital, and I go to jail. So she's not like the air. The air is a simple system. She is a complex system. So this case is very different from this case. If you have this case, what entropy should you use? Boltzmann. Because Boltzmann entropy is the logarithm of W. And if you take the logarithm of this, the n goes in front, and it is proportional to n, and that's extensive. That's thermodynamics, that's Clausius, 1850s, and that's okay. The same, it's proportional, it's proportional. It's proportional. Here, if you use Boltzmann entropy, you apply log onto this, it's going to be in proportion to logarithm of n. But thermodynamics says it is not to be proportional to the logarithm of n. It is to be proportional to n. So Boltzmann entropy for such a system, bye-bye. But if you take SQ with Q equal 1 minus 1 divided by rho, the same rho that you have there, if you use this entropy, that entropy is proportional to n. It's okay with thermodynamics, it is extensive, it's okay with Clausius, we are done. And you have another example, but it's not so important. So, here, you use a non-additive entropy, because I told you SQ is non-additive, in order that for that system to be extensive. So you take it non-additive in order to be extensive. Because if you take it additive, which is Boltzmann, it is non-extensive. And it is not what you want. So you see those two words are different concepts. Let me tell you more. This entropy, which is Boltzmann, is additive. SQ is non-additive. I put here another entropy, which also is non-additive. If you have this class, you should use Boltzmann entropy because it is extensive. And you should not use these or these because they are non-extensive. If you have this class, you must use SQ. If you have this class, you must use S delta. So if you married Boltzmann, Gibbs, Shannon, von Neumann, you will stay here until the death separates. But if you married thermodynamics and Clausius, and let me tell you that it is a better match, you will stay here until the death separates you. So what am I talking? I'm talking exactly the kind of thing that happened 3,500 years ago, even before the first Armenian historical notices, you said today 3,000.
Maybe more.
Well, that one is 3,500 years ago. So there was a big pharaoh whose name was Thutmosis the First. And there was a big pharaoh like Ramses the Second, and not like Tutankhamun, who was not a big pharaoh, but it just happened that they didn't rob the things. So Tutankhamun has become very famous because it's around everywhere because it's so beautiful. But Tutankhamun was not a big pharaoh. That one was a big pharaoh. So here you have the Nile, Egypt, and they had good scientists, the Egyptians, in particular good astronomers. And the north was said along the river. What river? The Nile, the only river they knew. So north is along the river. South is against them, and they were all happy. But one day, Tutmosis took his army and he invaded Mesopotamia, the Euphrates. There you have the Mount Ararat. You see here? So here it is. So he invaded here, and then they found the Euphrates. And the Euphrates runs the other way around. He runs from north to south. Here you have the Mediterranean Sea, there you have Cyprus. And the Euphrates runs like this. It goes to the Persian Gulf. And then, not only the astronomers were amazed, even the soldiers were amazed. What's going on here? The stars go wrong. Why? Because the Nile was a sacred river. So the Nile would go north, would come inside the Mediterranean Sea, which was infinity, and then it would go up in the stars and make the motion of stars. The river was moving the stars. And it would go back down here to Black Africa and would run again. So everything was cyclic and beautiful and perfect. But here, what's going on? So they did not understand. And when they came back to Egypt, they made this. So it was the fashion at the time. They made an obelisk. And they wrote here, that strange river, the Euphrates, in which when you go along the river, you go against the river. So what about that? When you go along the river, you go against the river. Incredible. Because they didn't know the Amazon. The Amazon does not run like this, nor like this. The Amazon in Brazil runs like this. Every child knows that. In fact, today, every child around the world knows that the flow of the rivers has nothing to do with the motion of the stars. But they didn't know. They thought it was one concept. The flow of the river and the motion of the star. But we know today those are two concepts. So when you distinguish the two concepts, you make an intellectual progress. This is extensivity and additivity. They are two different concepts. But if you have worked during 140 years with the air, you think they are synonyms, and they are not. Let me mention quickly a very beautiful result that was obtained 1 year ago by an Italian that works in Madrid. He established a connection between this entropy SQ and the Riemann zeta function. The Riemann zeta function is the most important function of the theory of numbers because it is directly related to prime numbers, 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, etc. So we still do not know what are the consequences of this, but this is a very beautiful connection between information theory and the theory of numbers. Let me change a little bit the subject, but still in mathematics. If you take the Boltzmann entropy, which is a sum of p, log p, and you optimize it, you make what in mathematics is called an extremization procedure, you get a Gaussian, which is like this. That Gaussian happens to be the attractor of the central limit theorem. I will say more about that. The central limit theorem is called central because it is the most important theorem in theory of probabilities. So the function, the distribution which optimizes Boltzmann entropy, happens to be the attractor of the famous central limit theorem. If you optimize SQ instead of optimizing Boltzmann entropy, you get this function that I will call Q Gaussian. And if Q equals 1, there you have the Gaussian, Q Q equal 2, you have a famous function, which is called the Cauchy-Lorentz function. And changing Q, you have all these things. Wouldn't it be nice if it was possible to generalize the central limit theorem in such a way that these functions are the attractors of the generalized central limit theorem? So we started suspecting that there was something like that in 2000, but we succeeded proving that it was like that 7 years later. And these are the two theorems that I am referring to. That one was done with the collaboration of two mathematicians in the United States. That one worked during several years in the same Tufts University where Bruce Bobozen was the head of the department. And the second theorem is with essentially people plus the mythic Murray Gell-Mann, who won the Nobel Prize and who predicted the existence of quarks. So we have inside plenty of quarks. So these two theorems are quite complicated to explain, but it's not so difficult to understand the logic of it. So the logic is the following. If Q equals 1, which means independence, if the variance, which is a statistical object, is finite, the attractor is a Gaussian. If it is diverging, the attractor is a so-called Levy distribution. Why this particular theorem is important? Because in nature, there are lots of Gaussian distributions. Lots. Why? We believe it is because of this theorem. Because the attractor does not depend on the details. So it's universal. For example, if a lady comes in with Chanel 5, a little bit later we smell it. That's convection plus diffusion. Diffusion is Brownian motion, that's a Gaussian. If instead of Chanel 5, it's another perfume, Christian Dior, we also smell it. Again, another Gaussian. So many Gaussians. Another example, if you take the distribution of the darkness of the skin, like the concentration of melanin, it roughly follows a Gaussian also. If you take the weight of people, it roughly follows a Gaussian. And have you ever observed a miracle? If you take a coffee, it can be an Armenian coffee, it can be a Turkish coffee, a Greek coffee, or an American coffee. And you put sugar here, and you do a couple of times like this, and a miracle happens. The entire coffee becomes sweet. How come? You put coffee here, and then 10 seconds later, the entire coffee is sweet. That's incredible. How this happened? Convection plus Gaussian diffusion, Brownian motion. So Gaussians are everywhere because of this theory. If Q is different from 1, you have strong correlations. And we prove here that the Q Gaussians are the attractors. And therefore, there is going to be many Q Gaussians in nature. And I'm going to show you some of them. There are very many of them. I just selected a few of them, and probably we'll have to cut half of the selection because of time. But I will show to you that this prediction says you are going to find Q Gaussians everywhere. And remember, Q Gaussians are directly related to the entropy SQ. But before showing you that, I would like to show a very interesting paper produced by the president of the American University of Armenia. 16 years ago, I gave a talk at the Boston University, and there was an audience, like you, and there was Bruce Bobozian sitting in the audience. And he heard what I said. And you might think he's not quick, because sometimes presidents are not quick, but he is quick. He went out of the seminar, and a few weeks later, he had produced this paper, which is the first experimental connection of the theory I'm talking about with experiments, with physics, with nature. The first one was done by him. It is this electron plasma, and there you have the experimental voids, and you see a black curve. That black curve, he proved, corresponds to Q equal 1/2, which is not Boltzmann. Boltzmann is Q equal 1. So, it's a pleasure to present to you this result here, in his presence. Let me go back. I want to show to you some few Gaussians in nature and elsewhere. So, this was done by Eric Lutz in 2003, and he said that if you have cold atoms in dissipative optical lattice with a lot of lasers, the distribution of velocities is not going to be Maxwellian, is not going to be a Gaussian. He said the distribution of velocities is going to be a Q Gaussian, and he said the formula for Q. So he did that in 2003. In 2006, that was verified in London by these people. So they verified the prediction by Eric Lutz in Quantum Monte Carlo, and even better in the laboratory with cesium atoms. Why did I say even better? Because I am a physicist. Maybe a professor who works with computational sciences, maybe he considers even better that one. I consider it even better here. Why? Because here, you control. You do what you want. And the computer does what you say. Physics is different. Physics is like this. You put cesium atoms, and you do not control. Nature controls. So you're just waiting to see whether nature is going to like what you said or not. Most of the time, she doesn't like. But when she likes, that's a big day to say, I discovered a secret of nature. This is why I said even better. So they verified the prediction of Eric Lutz 3 years earlier, even in the laboratory. Let me show to you and this work that appeared a few weeks ago by Guiomar Ruiz from Spain and Tasos Buntis from Greece. They happened to be together visiting my group simultaneously. And so we did this little paper. And what is the paper? The paper is here, you have a map. You put xy at time n, and for this little formula you get xy 1 time later, and you put it back, and you do it again, and again, and again. So you have a map. It goes somewhere in the space xy. This map is non-linear if mu is non-zero. So this map has a very special property. It is conservative. It is area-preserving, which means, for those that are familiar with the word Hamiltonian, this is like a little Hamiltonian with two dimensions, x and y. So we can see what the system is doing in the computer because it has only x and y. So you put a point and you see what happens. The air in this room, the phase space, has not two dimensions. It has the Avogadro number of dimensions. The Avogadro number is 10 to the power 23. Mm-hmm. It's a huge number. You will never see, we will never see, what makes a point in the phase space with the Avogadro number of dimensions. But we can see that one, because it has only two dimensions. So we solve it. That's the paper. So we took a region where the Lyapunov exponent is almost zero, and here you have x and y, and Guiomar put one point here, near the corner, near the center. And then she ran, tum, 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 2 to the power 9 iterations, and it appeared a kind of 8. And she continued, a kind of 8. And she continued, a kind of 8. And she continued this. And she continued this and this. So up to the moment when she stopped the computer, this was not fully black. It was like an 8. If it was fully black, that would mean that the system is ergodic, and therefore it follows Boltzmann, Gibbs, von Neumann, Shannon entropy. If it is not all black, that means that the system is non-ergodic, and it does not follow Boltzmann entropy. So maybe, because this Lyapunov exponent is not exactly zero, very close, but not exactly, maybe one day, after the end of the universe, this will become all black. But we leave that problem for the scientists after the end of the universe. For the scientists before the end of the universe, like us, this is not the problem. So why is this important? Because each of us is a non-ergodic system. The air is ergodic. And she's non-ergodic. And I wish you 100 years of non-ergodicity. You see, if you open that door, that window, the molecules that are inside, they go outside, they come in, they come out. They use all the possibilities, because they are independent and lonely. But if she goes there, she doesn't jump outside. She does not use all the possibilities. She only uses the possibilities that are consistent with her remaining as a living organism. So she selects very much what she's going to do. You remember the second class that I presented to you? They have strong correlations. They select. This is why languages exist. This is why Wall Street exists. So while this system does not like to be ergodic, what happens with the distribution of probabilities with the functions? That in this air, they give you a Gaussian. What happens? Well, here you have it. A Gaussian, it's a parabola here. This thing is not a parabola. So because the system is non-ergodic, it does not like Gaussians. I said a parabola because it is long linear, and therefore a Gaussian here appears as something like that. And you see, this is not like that. It has an inflection point. It follows roughly this black line, and this black line is a Q Gaussian with Q equal 1.6, which is not one. Maybe I will skip this. All of them are interesting, but I'm worried a little bit about time, even if that clock doesn't work, but the time does work. So here you have the famous LHC. So here you have Geneva, and there you have the accelerator, the Large Hadron Collider, which has 27 kilometers of perimeter. And in this, you have four big detectors, 1, 2, 3, 4. One of those four is the CMS detector, which you see here. You see a human being there? So you see the size of the detector. This is the biggest machine humanity has constructed until now. The biggest machine in thousands of years. This CMS collaboration has 2,500 scientists from all over the world. And they had published several papers in technology, engineering. Why? Because when you have 27 kilometers of electronics, vacuum, and all kinds of things, you can publish papers in technology. You, your children, your grandchildren, there is work for all of them publishing thousands of papers. But I'm going to show to you the first two papers in physics, not in technology. So the two first papers in physics are these two curves and this curve. So what is that you see here in log linear scale? In this experiment, at 7 tera-electron volt, which is a tremendous energy, they make collide two protons. So two protons like this, bam, they collide. To make them collide is a big mess, because the protons are so little that they go like this, and nothing happens. You want them to go like that, so you must have great precision to make them collide. When they collide, there is a terrible explosion, and it appears quarks and gluons. And those quarks are the quarks of Marie-Germain, and gluons, and something happens there, and then suddenly this soup of quarks and gluons explodes, and it sends out hadrons. And the hadrons go like 4 or 5 jets. And they measure the jet. And they measure the longitudinal motion and the transverse motion. And I'm showing to you the distribution of the transverse momenta. And those are the experimental points. And the black line here is a Q exponential. It is the function that comes out from the Q entropy. And Q is 1.15. If it was Q equal 1, it would be a straight line here. But you see, it is not. It doesn't like Q equal 1. It likes Q equal 1.15. And it likes that in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, almost 6 decades. 6 decades is a lot. But these people are very talented, and they went down here. They continued measuring here. And they obtained this. This is a very recent result. It appeared a few weeks ago. Here you have 15 decades. And this black line, this black curve, is the same Q exponential you saw before. You saw it here, in the beginning. Now you have it all. The same value of Q, it's the same function. And it fits the data in 15 decades. 15 decades means a precision of 0.00000015 zeros under 1. So here, you see two absolutely amazing things. First of all, how come these people can measure something in 27 kilometers that has a precision of 15 decades? That's the first amazing thing. That's incredible. The second amazing thing is, how come this little function that works here, it works down there? So when I saw this figure, I saw it in Turkey a couple of months ago, presented by these two people. He is from Poland, and he is from the United States. I was absolutely amazed. My God, 15 decades. So we have not much intuition, we humans. Maybe Mephistopheles has, but we don't have, about so many zeros. If I tell you 10%, you say, okay, I understand. If I tell you 1%, you say, okay, I understand. If I tell you 0.00000000%, you don't understand.
No,
you don't see.
Zero.
Yeah, you say zero, but it's not zero. There is a one later. So I decided to have some feeling about what is in 15 decades. And what I did, I represented in log-log Newton formula, the energy of Newton is p squared divided 2 times the mass. But Newton formula is okay here, but here it starts being wrong. And there you have the Einstein correction. This is Einstein formula, Einstein 1905. So this is Einstein formula, which shows that Newton was a genius, that he was not perfect. And Einstein was another genius, that he was not perfect. And one day, when people arrived to very high energies, Einstein would also fail. Why? Because any human intellectual construction, at some point, it fails. So you will fail. So where are we now? There you have Einstein's expression of the energy. If you take p equals 0, you have the only formula that reporters know, e equals mc squared. And what is the highest controllable energy that we have today? 7 tera-electron-volts. So there you have the curve for an electron, which is the same for a positron, and they can do collisions electron-positron if they wish. And everything is controlled up to 7 tera-electron-volts. So Einstein is correct up to here. After, we don't know. One day we will fail. So up to here is how many decades? 7 decades. 1, 2, 3, from that point, 7 decades. So Einstein, the famous Einstein formula, is experimentally controlled up to 7 decades. What you saw here is 15 decades. So when I made this comparison, you go to this adaptation. There you have a technological adaptation. So grams of women. And they, using the entropy SQ, they invented a procedure to process very tinyly the image. So there you have a mammogram. This is the breast of a woman. And there you see nothing. But then they process, and you see those little points? Those are microcalcifications. And there you have another example. A microcalcification like that one is 0.5 millimeter. So, not only your gynecologist, but even Hippocrates could not detect a 0.5 millimeter microcalcification. But with this image, you can. So it's very tiny, but it's cancer, so it's doing its work, and it will kill the woman. So, this is an important contribution they did, because with this processing, they went from 80% of truth. They could go to 97% of true positives. So 17 women more that you can save. Even one woman is important. What about 17 in 100? And not only that, simultaneously, they decreased the false positive from 8% to almost 0.4%. The false positive. What is a false positive? A false positive is when the doctor says, I'm very sorry, but I have to give you very bad news. You have cancer. So the woman says, wah, and she goes home, and the whole family, wah, and they cry during 15 days, and then they receive a phone call from the doctor saying, I have good news. It was a false positive. You have no cancer. So that's good news. But nevertheless, 15 days, the entire family was very, very bad. With their processing, you can increase the positive, the true positive, and you can decrease the false positives. It's a great contribution. Let me give you another example. This was done by 4 Chinese engineers. It was published a few months ago. 2012. Here is for guided surgery. This, the surgeon, is not looking where he is cutting. He's looking the monitor. He's looking there and he's cutting here. And in the monitor, he sees the tool. And You know what this is? A blood vessel is inside. A tiny thing. And look, you see everything. As if you were traveling inside there, you see these things, you see everything. Here is colon, the intestine. And here is bronchus, in the lung. Very tiny. And you see inside. Without cutting the person, you see inside. This is a line of somebody who does not smoke. If you smoke, this is very fuzzy. So don't smoke. Stop smoking. Very easy. Let me give you another example. That one was done by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Brazilians. So this is a study of multiple sclerosis. Very happy. This is what Stephen Hawking has. You know, like that. So there you have a cut of the brain, the original image. And here you have the processing with Boltzmann entropy, Shannon entropy, Q equal 1. And there you have the processing using Q different from 1. So you see much more details here than here. And one day Watson asked Sherlock Holmes, how do you find who is the murderer? And Sherlock Holmes answered, the relevant details. This is how I find the murderer. In the relevant detail for making the diagnostic of this multiple sclerosis was this one here. Here you would see it, and here you can see it. Porcelain, Limoges, the famous the cable. Oh, maybe. Here. Here. Oh, there we are. Right. Don't talk, don't deny. So there you have the famous porcelain of Limoges with the famous blue. And 1 year ago, it appeared this paper by these two French people who were at the Centre Européen de la Céramique at Limoges. And they studied experimentally cesium-implanted zirconia, and this enters into that kind of porcelain. And here, by using the normal procedure, classical simulated annealing, against generalized simulated annealing, this is Q equal 1. This is Q different from 1. So here you have the depth of the atoms. Here you have 100 samples, and they are slightly different. And here you have 100 samples, and they are all the same. And a good restaurant is not where sometimes the food is good and sometimes the food is bad. Yesterday we went to an Italian restaurant, and Professor Bohosian, he told me, here they have a great steak, always. He didn't say, let us see, maybe today is a great steak, maybe tomorrow it's nothing. So a good restaurant is where always the food is good. So here, they are always controlled, and they can sell it more expensive. And this is what they want, because they like money. So I went myself to Limoges many years ago, and they have so beautiful dishes and things and porcelain, fantastic. And there were some dishes, and I asked, how much is this? And they told me, I don't know, 50 French francs. Oh, and this, 120. And I look at them, but they are the same. No, they are not the same. Put many of them on top of the other. So you put here, and it is like that. You put here, and it is. This is why this is 120, and this is only 50. So you choose. So this is why they are interested in this instead of this, because they can raise the price. How are we doing in time? How many minutes more? Okay. So this is a contribution by two physicists into astronomy. So this appeared a few months ago, 2012. They found two new laws in astronomy. And I learned today in the Academy of Sciences of Armenia that one of the great scientists of Armenia was an astronomer, an astrophysicist. So they found two new laws, which are these. They measured the asteroids. There are regions in the planetary system which is plenty of stones, asteroids, thousands of stones. So they analyzed the statistics of those stones. And here you have the distribution of periods in log. You have seen in the movies when there is an asteroid that is going onto the Earth, it turns around. You have seen it turns around slowly and going down. Okay. This turning around, it has a period. And another asteroid has another period. And another asteroid has another period. So you have a distribution of probabilities of periods. And this is the black dots. And the red line here is a Q-Gaussian with Q equal to 2.6. So this is a new law of astronomy. This journal, in fact, it has one of the highest impact factors in astronomy. And they found another law. Here, the size. You can have an asteroid this size, this size, this size. And they made, they constructed the distribution of sizes of the asteroid. And those are the black dots. And the red line here is a Q exponential with Q equal 1.3. So, in physics, we are happy when this happens. Because I can tell you, I don't control, and they don't control, what the asteroids do. Nature controls. So when you find that nature likes a Q exponential, I say, oh, I found that secret of nature. Another example. These appeared this year, 2012. These people make physical approach to complex systems from Holland. And I want to show to you one of their applications. This is the cumulative distribution of returns of the biggest 100 American companies. The distribution as a function of returns for different times. You know these people in Wall Street and elsewhere, London Stock Exchange, they make buying and selling every 10 seconds, or maybe every 10 hours, or maybe every 10 days. So it depends on the time in which you act. By doing this, they have different times here. 4 minutes, 8 minutes, 16 minutes. All of them are Q-Gaussians. With Q, which is given here. For example, that one is Q equal 1.34. That one is Q equal 1.50. The longest the time, Q is the closest to 1. Why? Because when it is very long times, it loses correlation. And when it loses correlation, it becomes lonely. And when it becomes lonely and independent, it gives you Q equal 1. Another example, that was the doctoral thesis of Arpita Upajaya in Notre Dame University. She studied this, which is about 1 millimeter thick. So they were in a plate there, a lot of them. And she was feeding them. A disgusting thing she was putting there, but the inner being disgusting thing. And she was filming. And she was analyzing the motion of the cells of this. And they do not move like the molecules in this room. because the molecules in this room have Q equal 1. It's a Gaussian distribution, it's a Maxwellian distribution, Q equal 1. That one does not like that. It likes Q equal 1.5. You see, the experimental data on that line is a Q Gaussian with Q equal 1.5. She looks for food the same way you look for the keys of the car when you lost them. How do you look for the keys? You say, I left them in the kitchen. And you go to the kitchen and you look around. No, it's not in the kitchen. I left them in the garage. And you make a big jump from the kitchen. You go to the garage. And you say, no, it's not in the garage. What is it? Or maybe in my room. And then another jump. And you go. This is how you look for the keys that you lost. This is how she looks for food. You say, what about the hydravindissima that had Q equal 1? They all died. Darwin killed them. The only survivors are Q equal 1.5. Because these, they find food. So you say, why don't they use more Q equal 1.8, 2.3? Why not more? Because they are lazy, like all of us, like all living organisms. So if with Q equal 1.5 she finds food, say, okay, why am I going to make so big jumps from the kitchen to the kitchen of the neighbor? Why? To the garage is enough. Let me tell you a little bit about black holes. So this is a famous paper of Stephen Hawking, you know, the one which is in Cambridge University at the Department of Applied Mathematics and Theoretical Physics. And I gave a seminar there exactly 8 days ago. I was in Cambridge and I gave a seminar here. So, because I became interested in the black holes and the thermodynamics. And what is the abstract of that paper by Hawking? Here, he denies Boltzmann's. He says, this means that the standard statistical mechanical canonical ensemble cannot be applied when gravitational interactions are important. He says, and he's right, he cannot. And Gibbs knew that 1 century ago. So he's right. But look what he says here. The logarithm of the number of configurations is the entropy. He denies Boltzmann's here, and he uses Boltzmann's there. So the conclusion is that not only stupid people make mistakes, but intelligent people also make mistakes. Here you have an example. In the very abstract, there is an inconsistency because the distribution he does not want to use comes from here, and he uses that. This problem has been tackled by many people during decades, like all of these people. This is a Nobel Prize, Toft, Michael Duff, is fellow of the Royal Society in London. That one won a few months ago $3 million, the prize of that Russian that gave a lot of money to scientists. Well, and here you have a letter in Nature whose title is When Entropy Does Not Seem Extensive. And it says why the entropy is proportional to the surface rather to the volume. If it is a three-dimensional object, it should be proportional to the volume. But it's proportional to the surface, and therefore it's non-extensive. So during decades, people have been accepting this. And they say, well, thermodynamics, it's not okay for black holes. And you see here a paper in 2006 by these people. The area, as opposed to volume proportionality of black hole entropy, has been an intriguing issue for decades. So you don't understand why. And you have one more. 1 year ago. He is a great specialist, Padmanabhan. And he writes, thus, the extensive property of entropy no longer holds. He's violating thermodynamics. But if you ask to 100 physicists, what is the science in physics that will live forever? In 100, probably 100 will tell you thermodynamics. Everything will change. Thermodynamics, no. So he's violating thermodynamics. Nevertheless, he sleeps at night. So, how come? So, I attacked this problem because I became intrigued myself. How these people, they violate their mind. So, we found a solution. I will not tell you details, but the entropy to be used is not that of Boltzmann. It's this entropy as delta with delta equal to I have. And when you have this, you have a power of the famous Bekenstein-Hawking entropy, but power 3/2. This is proportional to the area, power 3/2 is proportional to the volume, and it is extensive. Now you can see that. So, let me tell you the very last application of these ideas. That was done with two friends and colleagues in Rio de Janeiro, that appeared 1 year ago. And what we did, there you have a lot of formulas, but I guess some of you have some contact with quantum mechanics. If you take in this equation, Q equal 1, here it becomes 1, phi 0 cancels with phi 0, and you have the Schrödinger equation, the famous, the most basic equation of quantum mechanics, that you will find in the textbooks. So this is a generalization of the Schrödinger equation. A non-linear generalization of Schrödinger equation. And for a free particle, we found the exact solution to be not a plane wave, which is the exponential of I k x minus omega, this is a plane wave, but the q exponential, q plane wave. And this is the exact answer. I was very happy about this. Why? Because you know what is a plane wave? Something like this. Forever. It's wider than the universe. And it is older than the universe. A single plane wave. So no human being can have a plane wave. It's off. This I didn't like since the time I was a student. Something that is like this. Well, the Q-plane waves are like this. They are localized in space and in time. And therefore, you can have a Q-plane wave in your pocket. So I said that's
quantum is here. Quantum is here.
Yeah, not a Q-plane wave. It's a plane wave. The solution for a photon is a plane wave.
The solution.
Yeah.
In reality?
Ask the God, not ask me. So, this is the exact solution. The energy comes out the formula of Newton, because this is non-relativistic. Planck relation is satisfied. The Broglie relation is satisfied for all values of Q, not only Q equal 1, which is the case that you will find in the textbook. Then we said, let us make it relative. So Klein-Gordon equation. This is a non-linear Klein-Gordon equation. We put inside a Q-plane wave. Again, it is the exact solution. And what energy comes out? Einstein equation. For all values of Q, not only Q equal 1. So we were amazed when we found this. So we said, let us take the queen. Who is the queen? Dirac. Dirac equation is relativistic. It has spin, it has matter, antimatter, electron, positron. Here the equation has everything. So let us take the queen. So we took the queen. Here you have a non-linear Dirac equation. The solution is, once again, the exact solution is a Q plane wave. And the energy is, again, the formula of Einstein, because it is Lorentz invariant is relativistic for all values of Q, not only Q equal 1 as it is in the textbooks. And I will stop here with the examples. If you want to know more, there are all these books. And if you want to know papers, you go to this address, where you will find thousands of articles dedicated to this business. And let me end by telling you how this happens, or how such things happen. And I would like to end in homage of the prophet with a text in literature, but not the literature he dominates, which is English, but Italian literature, which is as good as the English literature. Mamma mia. So this was written by Marco Bersanelli, who is an astrophysicist from Italy, in Milano. And this is a true story. Sofia is his daughter. So with his family, they were in Austria, and they were walking through a path and going up. And they found a lot of interesting things. And then at a certain moment, Sofia, la piccola di 3 anni, she was only 3 years old, she said, "Mamma, mamma, una fragola, a strawberry." She saw a strawberry. The other two children ran, but it was too late. La sorellina had already cooked the strawberries. So they started looking, and they found un'altra. E dopo un po', guarda qui, ce ne sono altre 3, 4. The hunting was open. They were finding strawberries everywhere. So when they came back, on the return, with my sincere surprise, doing the same path that we had done going up, we found a lot of them. 0 strawberries going up and 100 strawberries coming down. An effect statistically incredible. What had changed? We had changed. The strawberries.
Thank you very much for a wonderful topic, a mixture of mathematical concepts and entertaining nonetheless. Are there questions? We can take a few questions here, and then I suggest we go where the refreshments are.
I'm not sure if it's related to your talk, but there are so many things that you know also about this. How about quantum computers?
Yeah.
How far are we at still from quantum computers?
Oh, quite a lot. You will not use it. I think he will not use it. She will not use it. But our grandchildren, grandchildren, they will use it.
So we are still far away.
My question is about the cube, the range of the cube. So,
yes.
So it's all the examples were larger than 1, but not more than like 2 point something. But what can you comment on that, or about Q less than 1?
Yes. Well, first of all, I skipped an example which has to do with quantum computers. I have it there, but I skipped it because of time. That example has Q below 1. So there is no problem, it can be below 1. Now, as you notice, Q, my example is 1.5, etc. If those are Q exponential, the maximum value of Q is 2. If they are Q Gaussian, the maximum value of Q is 3. This is why you saw 1.5, 2.1.
So the maximum is 3?
For Q Gaussians. For Q Gaussians. Because you cannot normalize. They are so slow going down that the area diverges. And if the area diverges, it is not zero. The sum of probabilities must be 100. If it gives you infinity, yes. So this is why there is an upper value of Q, but there is no lower value. You can go down to minus infinity. That's an interesting point.
Minus infinity. Could you show the site of bibliographic actually?
Yes.
Well, if the presentation is available, then we can distribute it.
I can give a copy to Professor Bogosian. You get from him. There you have the bibliography. Yes.
Yes. And, as I know about Shannon's entropy, so you brought today the
consider all types of distributions, but I was showing here the classes that optimize an entropy. Not anyone, but those that optimize the entropy. Because those classes that optimize the entropy, they satisfy the generalized central limit theorem, and they are going to appear everywhere as you saw. They do it. But the people have used other distributions. The Q viable has been used by some people. Q stretch exponential has been used. I have not seen nobody using the Q log normal, but there is no problem, excepting you cannot derive it from an entropy, and possibly you cannot prove a central limit theorem. So maybe there are a few, but not many, many.
The question is about a little bit more cosmogonic and about the essence of the time. The entropy, the notion of the entropy, in many cases is related to the direction of the time, the
yes.
time flow.
Yes.
With the Q different than one,
it's the same. The flow is the same.
Flow is
so it's a pity because if we could inverse that, we could be older, younger, old, younger, but we cannot.
I understand that there is no inverse, no problem about that. But, however,
when you will be 80 years old, you will start having some problems. But today, I understand you have no problem.
But with this question, if the time is kind of independent variable, or it is derivative of the real mechanical motion, if it is related to the entropy, in some sense, if there is no motion, there is no time. If there is no increase of entropy, there is no time.
Yes.
And if the Q is smaller, it kind of dictates that it is possible that there are systems that there is no increase of entropy, and then there is no time.
For all values of Q, the second principle of thermodynamics is satisfied. There are maybe 20 papers in the literature showing that. But you put an interesting point there. And maybe Bruce knows Michel Barranger. You know him, at MIT, exactly. So I will give you a an image that Michel Barranger, emeritus professor from MIT today, that he gave in a colloquium in Texas, Denver. So he was giving a colloquium, and he said, you have a system that lives in a phase space. I showed to you a two-dimensional phase space for Guillaume Ruiz's business, and I showed you the phase space of the air here, three dimensions. So you have a box, and you have a phase space, and your system is here. And as a function of time, because of mechanics, Newtonian mechanics, quantum mechanics, relativistic mechanics, we don't care. Because of mechanics, it does like this. And as long as you follow it in box with the laws of mechanics, you know where it is, and the entropy is zero. And it goes, and the entropy is always zero, because you know where it is. But one day, you become tired. And you say, oh my God, I don't want to follow this all day long. And you say, I will change my description. I will say it is in the box. I will not say where. I will say it is in the box somewhere. At that moment, you increase the entropy. You increase the entropy. The little thing does not care. Mm-hmm. Because the little thing only cares about nature, about physics. From Aristotle. But you decided to change the description, and then the entropy increased because you lost information on the system. Because you don't care where it is. Do you care where these molecules are? Or do you care only that they are here so you can breathe and not too hot, not too cold? That's what you care. You don't want to know these molecules is here. You don't care. So the engineer who designed the air conditioning doesn't care about the positions. He cares about thermodynamics, to make an air conditioning like that or like that. Okay. So at the moment in which you decide to abandon the description and change into a less informative description, you increase the entropy.
But in reality it stays zero or the second.
What is reality? I'm telling you, if you want to follow it, it is zero for you. But if one day you say, I'm sick of this thing, I will only say it's inside the room, that's all. Then you change the description, the entropy changed. Reality, we were talking with the professor there about John Milton. Maybe he can say it better than me. He says, the one whose mind, human, have their own space and time, and they can make from heavens a hell, and a hell, heavens. That's in Paradise Lost, John Milton. So you decide whether you want to follow this in all details, or just to say it is in the box. You decide. When you decide, the entropy accommodates to that information pool.
Before we
you will find, just to be fair, you will find physicists that will tell you this is nonsense. Entropy has nothing to do with me. Entropy has to do with the system. Well, you discuss with them. If you discuss with me, my answer is what I told you. It depends on you. What do you want to know on the system?
I think what I'll suggest now is that we continue the discussion, but up in the Akyan Gallery. As I said, there's refreshments up there. We can have informal conversation with Professor Tsallis there. Before we do, I'd like to go back to the comment that he made earlier about the talk that he gave at Boston University in 1996, which is when I first met him. And as I was sitting in the audience, I saw that what he was proposing solved a problem that I couldn't figure out how to solve. And it was a system that turned out to have Q different from one. And as he spoke, I could see that it applied. So I sent him an email afterwards. And
oh, you sent me an email?
I think so, yeah.
I don't remember.
And so with, we may or may not
not remember was that you were very, very encouraging and helpful. And I think one of the wonderful things about people who are scientists and researchers, one of the best qualities that they can have is when they're willing to spend time helping their colleagues, and younger colleagues in particular, work something out and just devote time to it, devote energy to it. You and I exchanged quite a few emails over the subsequent days, and I thought that it was wonderful that you were encouraging like that, and it did lead to that paper. So likewise, I was very pleased to welcome you here at AUA. This, by the way, is the first time that you've visited the former Soviet Union, so we're happy that Armenia was the first place in the former Soviet Union you visited. And what I'd like to do is present you with this book, so you will remember it.
Okay. I will remember anyhow, without the book also. And, thank you very much.
So enjoy that. And what I'm going to suggest is now we thank Professor Tsallis, and we go up to the room, and we enjoy the refreshments and continue the discussion. So thank you very much.